do 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 do. Do you think only boys can change the world of music? Today we're going to look at 10 girls who changed music forever. Welcome. Do you know that tune? You might. Some of you might call it the music of J.S. Bach, and he may have written it, possibly. But the only reason we know about it is not because of J.S. Bach, but actually because of his wife, Anna Magdalena Bach. Anna Magdalena Bach is number 10 on my list today of women who have changed music forever. So let's get to it. And if you've taken classical music lessons at all, you know about Anna Magdalena Bach, or at least the music that was in her notebook. Let's explain that. Anna Magdalena Bach, second wife of J.S. Bach, she was a musician as well. In fact, she was a professional singer. She was a soprano singer. She married Bach in 1721, about 18 months after his first wife died. She immediately was a mother to all the children of Bach, all of Bach's children from his first wife, so which was a lot of kids. And then Bach and her ended up having 13 children of their own. Now, some of them didn't survive childhood, but still 13 children over a 19-year period. So that means most of the time she was pregnant during those 19 years. In 1723, they moved to Leipzig, which is a city in Germany, and Bach basically became the head musician in the churches of Leipzig. Not one church, but the whole collection of Lutheran churches that were there. And on top of that, he was expected to teach the students as well. So it was a huge job. And Anna Magdalena Bach was his partner in this life that they lived. One of the big things she did was she was a copyist. She would copy the music scores that Bach wrote. And so actually, without her copying some of the scores, perhaps we would not know of some of Bach's music today. Thank you, Anna Magdalena Bach. What else she played? She was a keyboard player and, of course, a singer. And she also was in charge of the education of her children, including the musical education. And more than one of her children became musicians and composers in their own right. And that music is still being played today. Thank you, Anna Magdalena Bach, for all these beautiful pieces that were in her notebook that she kept in her home, that she used to train her children, and when company would come, they would play and do music together. And also, we want to thank you for enabling the life of J.S. Bach, who many feel is the world's perhaps greatest composer of all time. Musician number 9 on our list is Marie Anna Mozart. Okay, just as Walt Disney had his brother Roy to help him be successful, and Bill Clinton, President Bill Clinton, had Hillary Clinton to push his career along until he became president, Mozart had his very special sister, Nannerl, as she was called, Marie Anna Mozart. Here's a portrait of them as children, and you can see in this portrait, she's older. She's 4 years older than Mozart, and the music is in her hands, not his. At this point in the game, she was probably the better musician of the two. She played piano and violin, and they both received music lessons from their father. Nannerl, by the time of 7, she was playing keyboard, and 3-year-old Mozart was listening in and hearing her play violin and piano, and of course, being a 3-year-old younger brother, he wanted to join in as well. So I am not sure that we would have ever had Mozart as we know him without having a 4-year older sister who was in the music game. These two ended up touring Europe more than once as a musical duo in the care of their father, and they became famous. And of course, Mozart started writing music and he became even more famous as a composer than as a performer. Let's look at a couple more pictures of her. Here's her as a little bit older child. And see if I can zoom in on that a little bit. And one more, this is her as an adult with this lovely big poofy hair. Why didn't she achieve Mozart's fame? It's because she was a woman. And back in their day, that day, she was expected when she became marrying age, which of course was in the teenage years, she was expected to settle down, have a family, which she did. And so Wolfgang continued to achieve the great fame that he did, and Nan Earl settled down and had a family. However, she continued to make music, and in her later years, she actually became a piano instructor and continued to keep the music alive. So thank you, Marie Anna Mozart, for being an inspiration for Wolfgang and changing the world of music. Number 8 is Fanny Mendelssohn, this lovely young lady here pictured in here. Fanny was 4 years older than Felix, and they also were both incredible musicians. Now, unlike Mozart's sister, Fanny actually had many, many published works of music. However, for most of her lifetime, they were published under her brother's name. That's right, they were published and attributed to Felix Mendelssohn because she was a woman. And in the early 1800s, you were not allowed, women were not allowed to publish and compose music, and it was considered socially unacceptable and an embarrassment, and in certain cases immoral for women to have a career in music. And so she had to secretly publish under her brother's name. It was only later in her life that she dared to publish in her own name. But she composed hundreds of tunes, both for instruments and also for voice. She wrote, 250 songs for voice. Wow, that's crazy. Let's listen to just one, a little bit of a piece. The Attica Quartet is going to play a string quartet from Fanny, and I'll put the link down below if you want to hear the whole thing. Absolutely beautiful. Thank you, Fanny, for your beautiful music. Number 7 on our list is Clara Schumann. Clara Schumann, this lovely young lady. And this is her more famous husband here, Robert Schumann. Robert Schumann. Now again, these first ladies, the first three that I've talked about are related to a man in music. But we have to remember, this was an era and time when the men would become famous, but women weren't supposed to have a career. But in a time when women weren't supposed to have a career, Clara Schumann's talent was so great that it could not stop her career from happening. She was an incredible pianist, and she would give piano concerts and recitals. And she actually was invited all over Europe to do those. And she would get paid very, very good money to do that. So of the couple, Clara Schumann is the one who made the money and kept the family in business. Now, their love story is quite a story. Clara's father did not want her to marry Robert Schumann, but going against his wishes, she secretly dated him and ended up marrying, and their love story is quite a story. They ended up having 8 children, and much music that Robert wrote was to his wife. He was so enamored with her. However, they were, like many some musicians, they're awkward. They're awkward socially. But what Robert would do was tell of his love in his music, tell of his love for his wife in his music. Clara, let's talk about her. Not only was she an amazing pianist that performed throughout her life, and she became incredibly famous for that. She also composed 460 musical works. But what's amazing, she was so in love and enamored with her husband and what he had done that that after Robert died, she spent the last 35 years of her life promoting not her music, but Robert's music. And perhaps the reason that Robert Schumann is so famous as a composer today and his music is so well known today is because of this famous pianist she spent the last 35 of your lives promoting and sharing and making sure his music got the attention that she felt it deserved. So thank you, Clara Schumann, for your amazing music and also giving us and sharing with us the music of your husband, Robert Schumann. I want to just play a little bit of Isada Cannon Mason, her performing just a little bit of Clara Schumann's Scherzo No. 2 in C minor. There should be a link below if you want to listen to the entire thing. Number 6 on our list is the great Ella Fitzgerald. Ella Fitzgerald would absolutely transform the landscape of jazz singing, of pop music, of ethnic integration in the United States. We cannot underestimate her influence. Ella Fitzgerald had a terrible childhood, grew up very poor, and had some real trouble her teenage years. She ended up as an orphan on the street and ended up in trouble with the law, and also had some child abuse from some of her caretakers after her parents died. At age 15, she found herself alone and homeless. Then she moved in with her sister and another sister, and they were trying to make things work. One night she got, by chance, she got a chance to perform at the Apollo Theater at an amateur night. And she was a dancer and she was going to dance a number, except she was going to go last. And the people before her were a dancing pair of sisters, and they were astonishing. And Ella knew there was no way that she could follow that up. So on the spot, she decided to change her plan, and she decided to sing instead and asked the live musicians that day, can you play this song, please? And she sang that night, and the audience loved it. And since she was the last performer, they made her sing another that night. And that started her career. By the time she was 18, she got her big break with a gentleman named Chick Webb, who was a big band director at that time. And he said, hey, come on tour with me. So she loaded the bus at 18. With a group of guys. She was the only girl on the bus, and off they went traveling around the country. At age 21, she got another big break with this hit that went number one for 17 weeks on the chart called A Tisket a Tasket. Here it is in a movie shortly after that.
A tisket a tasket, a brown and yellow basket. I send a letter to my mommy. On the way I dropped it. I dropped it, I dropped it. Yes, on the way I dropped it. A little girlie picked it up and put it in the bucket. She was trucking on down the avenue, but not a single thing to do. She went a peck, peck, pecking all around. When she spied it on the ground, she took it, she took it, my little yellow basket. And if she doesn't bring it back, I think that I will die.
Later in her career, she developed a very special relationship with the man she called Pops, Louis Armstrong, who was another great of the jazz world. And they had a lifelong friendship. They were never romantically involved, but they were very good friends. And I think they were musically, their hearts were the same. They brought joy all over the United States and all over the world, performing and singing and just making people happy. Here's a duet with them.
I really can't stay.
But baby, it's cold outside.
I've got to go away.
But baby, it's cold outside.
This evening has been
hoping that you
so
drop in.
Very nice.
I'll hold your hands, they're just like
my ice. Mother will start to worry.
Beautiful, what's your
hurry? And father will be pacing the floor.
Listen to the fireplace roar.
So really, I'd better scurry.
Beautiful, please don't
well,
hurry.
Maybe just a half a drink more.
Put some records on while I pour.
The neighbors might think.
But baby, it's bad out there.
Say, what's in this drink?
No cabs to be had out there.
I wish I knew how.
Your eyes are like starlight
to break
now.
The spell.
I'll take your hat. Your hair looks
small. I ought to say no, no,
mind
no,
if
sir.
I move in closer?
At least I'm gonna say that I tried.
What's the sense of hurting my pride?
I really can't stay.
Oh, baby, don't hold out, baby.
Ah, but it's cold outside.
In the 1930s and 40s, big bands became extremely popular, and Ella sang live with these musicians. And she learned a trick from Pops, from Louis Armstrong, who used, when he didn't play trumpet, he would often use his voice as sort of another instrument and do solos. And so Ella learned this trick, and she took it one step farther. And today we call this scatting, where you use the voice as an instrument to take a solo. And nobody has ever done it better than Ella. Here's Ella scatting a little bit.